Okay, now we need the expression for all those four functions, psi 1, 0, psi 1, 1, psi 0, 0, psi 0, 1. And then we need to integrate those. So these 16 quantities, you pick one that you want me to evaluate. There is no way we are going to do all 16 of them, right? It's obviously, it will take a lot of time to do all 16 of them. So you pick up one, and the procedure is same for each one of them. So you can decide which one to take. And I admit, in the morning when I did it, my answer and the answer I have in this one did not match. So I hope when we do it here, we will do it correctly. Because now there will be 40 brains working on it. In the morning, I was the only one working on it. So, and of course, on this one also, I am the only one who worked on it. So I did not have anybody else check it. And I was surprised that my answer did not match with what I have in these notes. It was off by some constant. Okay, so because the reason I'm picking these up is because I need to write the expressions for all these four functions, and we derived for two of them, and the remaining two we did not derive. So pick up one of these, and then I will write the expressions, and then I will differentiate it and integrate it to see what we get. Any preference you have on which one you want? I'm sorry? First row, first column? Third column, this one. Okay, good. So what we need is then psi 1, 0 and psi 2, 0. 0. Is 1 minus 3 x minus xi square over he plus twice x minus xi square over he. Oh no. Psi 2. So will be 3 times x minus xi over he square minus twice x minus xi over he cube. I know you don't have the expressions for, you have the expression for psi 1, 0 because we derived that yesterday. You don't have the expression for psi 2, 0. I mean, you take my word for it. So if you differentiate the first one, first time 0 minus 3 into 2 is 6, x minus xi over he square plus 6 x minus xi square over he cube. Then differentiate it again with respect to x. minus 6 over HE plus 6 times 2 is 12. Over HEQ. Okay? So we are differentiating this twice. First with respect to first derivative is this, and then this is the second derivative. Oh, yeah, yeah, sorry, thank you, thank you. Thank you. Yes, 6 over H is square, right. Okay, so the psi 2 0 prime is 6 x minus xi over H e square minus 6 x minus xi square over H e cube. And then if you differentiate again, so we have psi 2 0 double prime is 6 over H E square minus 12 over H E cube times X minus XI. Okay, so now let's evaluate that. So we have this gamma, which is a function of X. And psi 1 0 double prime is this quantity. So it's minus 6 over H E square plus 12 X minus X I over H E cube. And then you multiply this by psi 2 0 double prime, so that is 6 over H E square minus 12 over H E cube X minus X I dx. So in the, is it okay? In the heat conduction problem that we talked about yesterday, we said when that gamma is variable, for the nonlinear problem, gamma was a, or the thermal conductivity was a function of temperature. And I said you can evaluate, you can take initial temperature as 70. What do we do here now? Gamma is a function of X. Of course, you will be given gamma. Remember that gamma is coming from the fact that we had E equal to E0 alpha to the alpha multiplied by X and beta as a, sorry, alpha as a function of X and beta as a function of Y. This part was absorbed in finding the neutral surface because we integrated beta Y as if then Y dy from minus Y neutral axis to H minus Y neutral axis and set that equal to zero or something close to it. So we found the location of the neutral axis. So that beta was taken care of in this expression. Alpha is the one that we, that is why we are getting that gamma as a function of X. So alpha is supposed to be known to you. Because you are, even if you are doing the problem for an FGM, functionally graded material or inhomogeneous material, you assume or you know the distribution of the Young's modulus as a function of X and Y. So that implies gamma is known to you. So there, so it depends upon how coarse or fine a mesh you are taking. So there are several possibilities. So one is that you, I think I don't need this anymore. I hope I don't need it. So one possibility is take gamma equal to a constant evaluated at the center of the element. So if you have elements, this what you will have is different values of gamma for each element. Other possibility is in each element, you write gamma as gamma j psi j0 plus gamma j prime psi j1. J goes from 1 to 2 because you have two nodes per element. Does it make sense? You know gamma, so you can differentiate it, which means you can evaluate the value of gamma at each node. You can evaluate the value of the slope at each node. And now you know these functions, psi j0 and psi j1. So what we are doing is we are approximating gamma, no matter how complex it is, by a cubic function. Because each one of these is x to the power cube. So this one might be a better approximation than this one. Which means if you refine the mesh, this probably will converge faster than this one. There are no guarantees. I did not say if you I spoke this probably will converge faster. I do not know beforehand. I cannot guarantee it beforehand. But since this is a better approximation than this one, the hope is that this will give a better solution for a coarse mesh. Yesterday I did not say that. I said you can take thermal conductivity to be a constant. We can do the same thing for thermal conductivity. We can do the same thing for thermal conductivity. Yesterday we had only two functions. So you can express it in terms of those two functions. But there are other choices too. And one other choice is, which we have not talked about yet, is because we will evaluate these integrals. Generally, we evaluate them numerically. We use numerical integration. How many of you have... how many of you remember Simpson's rule? Okay, so Simpson's rule is a numerical technique to evaluate these integrals. And better than Simpson's rule is Gauss integration rule. Gauss integration rule, it requires fewer number of points than the Simpson's rule does. To give you the same exact value, so if for the Gauss integration rule, if you have a polynomial of degree 2n plus 1, if you have a polynomial of degree 2n plus 1, and if you evaluate that from minus 1 to 1, this, of course, I know you can do by hand, and so don't think that way. So if you have a polynomial of degree 2n plus 1, then Gauss integration rule requires n plus 1 integration points. And those are the minimum number required. I am not telling you where the locations are, but then you have to know the weights also. And that's another small exercise to find out where those n plus 1 points are and what are the corresponding weights, but they are given in many textbooks. Actually, if you Google it, Gauss integration rule, you will get the table. It will tell you if you want to use 2 points, these are the coordinates of the points and these are the corresponding weights. If you want to use 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, it will give you the coordinates of the points and the corresponding weights. And also one can derive how they get it, like how you get it. So that's another possibility, that if you are evaluating this numerically, if you are evaluating this integral numerically, and if you are using, say, three integration points, you use the value of gamma at those integration points. Then you don't have to do something like that. But if gamma is not a polynomial, then you don't know how many integrations to use. You can approximate gamma by this expression, and that will, then you can figure out how many integration points to use. Both are approximations, so it makes no difference whether you use this approximation, this one, or this one. They are not equivalent in the sense that if you need five elements for the solution to converge in this approach, you may need three in this one, you may need four in this one. These are pure guesses, no guarantees. Okay, so for our case, so xi to xi plus 1, because we are integrating over one element. And let's say I will evaluate this at the centroid. So I can take it out of the integral sign. Because now it's a constant. You have evaluated it. So it's a numerical value. You can take it out of the integral sign. So now let's look at this. So I have basically both of them are the same, because this is minus plus plus minus. So I can take out minus sign here and write it minus. So you can square it. And if you can multiply these two terms, and then you can integrate it. So is it okay, or do you want me to do it? This is like a minus b, a minus b. So it is a minus b squared. So you will get a squared plus b squared minus 2ab. And all you will get is 1. This is a constant. This one is a polynomial of degree 1 in x. And quadratic term will be a polynomial of it will be x minus xi squared. And all of us know how to integrate this. I won't use the word trivial, but anyway, it's a simple integration. And then you can plug in the limits from xi to xi plus 1. At the lower limit, xi, when x is equal to xi, this term will give you 0 contribution. So your final answer will be in terms of the element length. Okay? Should we skip that? Okay. So we skip it, and then so this is for one element. But generally, depending upon the load given to you and the shape of the beam. If the beam is of uniform cross-section, if the cross-section is uniform, and let's assume the load is uniformly distributed, whether the load is pointing up or down makes no difference. If you look at the expression for W, what do we get? Like, is it a, what degree of polynomial do we get? Yes, beam is uniformly distributed. Yeah, Pranav, you are trying to answer the question. You are asking him. Oh, you are telling me? Pardon me? Oh, please repeat the question. So I have this beam of uniform cross-section, homogeneous material is constant. So what will be my solution for W? What kind of polynomial will I get? Pardon me?
Constant quantity.
So I should have EI W4 equal to the distributed load, right? So if you integrate it, we'll get 3 is F over EI X plus constant. So now you can guess what will be the order of the polynomial. So if I have second derivative will be X square over 2 CX plus D. So it will be fourth order. It will be fourth order. Okay, now to make, I remove this, but I apply a point force and a moment at the ends. So now what will be the solution of this differential equation? What will be the order of W and
third order?
Good. So W will be A plus BX plus CX square plus DX cube. We are applying loads at the ends. The values of A, B, C, and D will depend upon P0 and M0, and of course Young's modulus and the moment of inertia, I. What is the degree of polynomials in our basis functions? 3. Good. One element will do the job. One element will do the job. It will give you exact solution. Because our approximate solution is a complete, expressions in this one, they are complete polynomials of degree 3. The word complete means that you can express 1, x, x square, and x cube as a linear combination of so psi 1, 0, psi 1, 1, psi 2, 0, and psi 2, 1. Which means the constant term A can be expressed as a linear combination of those. X can be expressed as a linear combination. X square can be expressed. And X cube can be expressed as a linear combination of those. So one element will do the job. Of course, if you change some, if you make it an antenna, which means I, area moment of inertia with x, or you make it FDM, which means E varies with x. If you say, assume E varies with y, it doesn't cause any problems. It's only variation in x is a problem. Then you will need more elements. Or if your load distribution is not zero here, but is something like this, yeah, then you will need more elements. So depending upon how the load is distributed, like how, what kind of order of polynomial you have for the load, then your solution will no longer be cubic in x, but it will be some other power of x. Less than 3 is okay, but you cannot get less than 3 because you have a fourth order differential equation. And if you integrate it, the minimum you will get is x cube. And if the loads are x to the power 5, then your solution will be x to the power 8 or 9. Does it make sense? So depending upon the variation of the load, depending upon the variation of the cross section, depending upon the variation of the elastic modulus, the number of elements we will need will be different. We may or may not get the exact solution because our approximate solution is a combination of polynomials of degree 3. And if your solution involves some exponential terms, then we may not be able to reproduce them by polynomials of degree 3. May not be. But no matter what kind of function you take, if you have enough segments, on each segment, you can fit a cubic polynomial and come very close to the given curve. So you can think of this given curve as the solution of the exact solution of the problem. So on each segment, you are approximating that exact solution by a cubic polynomial. So if you take lot of segments, then your approximation will keep on improving. So on each segment, the error in each segment, roughly speaking, the error is of the order of element to the power 4. Element size to the power 4, roughly speaking. Because we are using polynomials of degree 3. So if you expand your solution in terms of Taylor series up to cubic terms, we are approximating well. The error will be in the x to the power 4 terms, which means h to the power 4. That is a foreign homogeneous. Well, if your this solution here accounts for everything in the sense that if the body is made of an inhomogeneous material or the cross section is not uniform, that's already taken care of in this exact solution. So now you can see one way to estimate the error in your solution, and you can estimate how many elements you will need. So for a solution of this type, of course, one element will not do the job. I mean, you will get a solution, but it may not be that close to the critical solution of the problem. Same thing that you mentioned yesterday will show up. I think you are Dr. Verma, right? Now, same thing will show up that at the wherever the two nodes meet, slopes will be continuous. But the shear force and the bending moment, they are not proportional to the slopes. See, bending moment involves curvature, which means like next derivative. But that's discontinuous. Shear force involves third derivative. That's discontinuous. So as you keep on defining the mesh, so-called fictitious point forces and moments, their magnitude will keep on getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Which means if you find from the left or the right, they will be getting closer and closer to each other. They will never disappear. This is numerical solution. We are not ensuring that the curvature is continuous. We are only ensuring that the slope is continuous. So the question comes up now, how do you judge the quality of your solution? Pardon me? That is the error in your solution. The error in the solution is approximately equal to the, is proportional to the element size to the power 4, non-dimensional, because this is HE is, I'm not saying that you take HE in centimeters or meters, but you have non-dimensionalized the length by dividing, by taking x going from 0 to 1 rather than going from 0 to 10 centimeters. Because otherwise you will say the error is proportional to centimeter raised to the power 4. But normally we non-dimensionalize things. Okay, so any questions? Speak up. How did I come to the x to the power 4? Okay, I will explain. So let's assume that we are given, at this point, we were given deflection and slope. So our solution, deflection matches with the analytical solution because both approximate solution and the analytical solution satisfy that boundary condition. Assume that lambda penalty parameter is large enough so that you have exactly gotten W equal to 0. Actually, in this case, no matter what you will take for penalty parameter, because the right-hand side is 0, so you will get W equal to 0, slope equal to 0. So now look at this element, this element only, the first element. So we have analytical solution and the numerical solution this is of the type A plus BX plus CX square plus DX cube because we have complete polynomials of degree 4. So if you expand your analytical solution in terms of Taylor series, then you should get terms like this. First four, three terms should be like that. And then the fourth term will be of the order of x to the power 4. And since we are expanding about x equal to 0, so I did not write x minus x something. Right? This one, A, B, C, and D can be matched with A bar, B bar, C bar, D bar. So what will be the difference between these two solutions? Power 4. And that maximum is value of x is the element size. So there's power of 4 difference here. Then if you go to the next one, still the difference will stay as to the power 4, not, you don't multiply them. The magnitude, the constant of proportionality will change. But because in every element, you are expanding it in terms of Taylor series. Does it make sense? So roughly speaking, the error is proportional to element size to the power 4 because we have basis functions are complete polynomials of degree 3. The key word is complete. If they were not complete polynomials, say if the term of x were missing, then we will not be able to match this term. And then the error will be proportional to the element size. Again, these are approximate estimates. But it gives you an idea, right? How many elements you should take. Try it. Yes, yes. Because in that case, you don't have this term.
I don't have to take multiple elements.
No, you will not need multiple elements. You can try it. I think writing these four, this is now, relatively speaking, trivial exercise, because you have a 4x4 stiffness matrix, 4x1 variables of unknowns, two of them are known, W and W prime are known, so W1, so D1, D2 are known, so you have to solve for D3, D4, and you will see that your solution will come out to be pretty good. I think so. You can try it and then maybe let me know tomorrow. I should not assign you homework without assigning everybody else homework, but no, you don't have to tell me tomorrow. But I'm reasonably sure, yes, you will get it. You have tried it. Yeah, okay. No, long ago. Now, maybe when you took the class in Blacksburg. Okay, so now we were talking about how do you estimate errors. So yesterday we saw one estimate, and that is that zero means we are going to compare only the function itself. So this zero, and double bars means in mathematics terms we call it norm, which is really the length of a vector. And since these are functions, these are like, it's a function of x that goes from 0 to L or 0 to 1. So either you can define it as a soup norm, which we discussed yesterday, so I won't repeat it for you. Other possibility is that you look at Wx numerical. Minus analytical square it dx. So this is from 0 to L. This is also from 0 to L. So you look at the difference. Excuse me, between the numerical solution and the analytical solution. Square it, and then this is also squared here. So this will give you an average error. This one is the strongest indicator of error, which I did not define because we defined yesterday. This one is the strongest indicator. So sometimes it's hard to get convergence in this norm. In this one, it's easy, relatively speaking. But this is not a very good indicator, because even though your deflections have converged, energy may not have converged. So we should look at the energy norm. And the energy norm involves second order derivatives. So those, as you can see, second order derivatives are not that easy to, you will see that it's not easy to converge in terms of the energy norm. So I will put 2. This 2 means we are considering now second derivatives. So this, again, square. So it's 0 to L. Let's call it, E, the difference between the two. Because then otherwise I have to write many terms. So difference between numerical and analytical solution is E. So it will be E square plus E prime square plus E double prime square. Energy due to bending, which means moment times curvature. So you need moment square. This is, we are assuming we are talking about isotropic linear elastic materials. Tomorrow, I will discuss nonlinear Well, I will discuss both material and geometric nonlinearities, so that GIAN does not come and shoot me in Blacksburg. That is the title of the course. Okay? So we will cover both geometric and material nonlinearities tomorrow for the beam problem. We will not be able to find an exact solution of the problem. We will not find the approximate solution also, because you will see it takes more time. But you will have the equations. And there are very, very few papers in the literature. You can count on your one hand, which roughly means five. If there are not five, there may be 10 that do those kind of problems. Otherwise, most people do not consider all of the nonlinearities. It's questionable how much difference they make. I cannot answer that question beforehand. It varies from problem to problem. But if you have a surgeon, medical doctor, operating on you, or me, I mean, no matter who, and they are dealing with soft tissues. If you use all our beam theory for that kind of soft tissue, only God can save us. Because if he thinks it will take 1 Newton force to pull it, it might take 10 Newton force, or it might take 1/10 of a Newton force. So for those kind of problems, nonlinear theories are critical. But if you have a beam made of steel with a factor of safety of 5, all of Bernoulli beam theory is fine. Yeah. So, okay, so to make this story short, so this is dx, and then we have to normalize it, because otherwise this error has no meaning. So when we find the energy from the analytical solution. So this will be a number, whether it's like somewhere hopefully much less than 1, and you can decide whether you want this tolerance, whatever tolerance you want, and you can keep on refining the mesh to achieve that. In this case, using higher order polynomials is not a viable choice, because we already have to do quite a bit of work to find these. So the better choice is to keep on refining the mesh till the solution has converged. Oh, integrand is, say, this is E. Yeah. Because I didn't want to write that difference over and over. Right? So this will give us difference in the deflection. That is difference in the slope. That's difference in the curvature. We generally, when we write 2, this 2 indicates that we are going up to second order derivatives. We generally do not skip anything in between. I mean, you can skip it, but if something converges in E double prime, it will converge in E prime and E. Because E double prime is more, it's harder to get convergence in. And we cannot go generally beyond E double prime, because our basis functions are only cubic polynomials. So you can differentiate twice, okay. Third time you will differentiate, you will get constants. Fourth time, you will get zeros. So there's no point in computing it. But physically, energy means only you go up to second order derivatives. And as in our weak formulation, we only went up to second order derivatives. So there are many variations of these. I mean, you can have beams on elastic foundation, you can have beam on a spring at the end, and all of these problems you can do. And the approach is basically same, except that the boundary conditions will be different. If you have a spring here, then the boundary condition will be different. One way to introduce nonlinearity is to make this spring nonlinear. Right? Then the problem will become nonlinear. it was, you can also say that you have a sport that is offset by a distance. And then depending upon the load you apply, whether it contacts the sport or not, will affect the solution. So there are many variations that you can think of. You can immerse this beam in fluid. And then you will have a fluid structure interaction problem. And that will be a different story. So of course, I cannot do all of them. And I cannot even, I don't know. Well, I have not solved all of them. This one, you give it to your deforms class in undergraduate. And same thing about the spring. This one also, if it is a linear spring, you can either use energy methods or you can use the weak formulation that we have been doing. I prefer weak formulation. Then I don't have to worry about whether there's a stored energy for a viscoelastic material or not. And same thing, if you are doing a problem for a fluid, viscous fluid, Navier-Stokes fluid, I don't have to worry about how much energy is dissipated if I work in terms of weak formulation. But that's only my preference. Doesn't mean that is the best choice. No implication of that type. Okay, so I think I'm done a little earlier than probably lunchtime. It's 11:45 now. So it's 12 o'clock, so we are on time. So enjoy your lunch, and then we will work on the heat conduction problem when the thermal conductivity depends upon temperature. And please bring your calculator or laptop or whatever so you can compute some numbers.